When David wakes up, he is in an ambulance and heading to the hospital, strapped down to a gurney. Lucy and the imp talk about what pills David takes to abjure the effects of his chrome augmentations. But it becomes clear that David isn't on anything as Lucy laughs at the audacity of this. The EMT suddenly puts a gun to David's head. He's being taken in since his Sandevistan is worth a lot on the black market. Lucy knocks out the EMT nurse.
Just past the hospital. Oh my.
Listen, Chum, this kid got an implant on him that'll fetch at least a couple K. So just sit back and relax and we'll...
Is that right? You like cut a deal with some scavengers?
I said sit back and chill or we'll probe you for chrome too.
Sorry, David. Looks like we gotta change our plans. You're back to 20.
And busts David out of the ambulance right in the middle of a tunnel highway. She avoids oncoming traffic by maneuvering the wheeled gurney in an incredible display of agility and reflexes. Lucy takes David to his doctor. A surgeon is impressed that the boy was actually able to use a Sandevistan speed implant 8 times in one day before he passed out. It's an unprecedented number. The surgeon advises David to have a maximum of 3 uses per day unless he wants his brain to pop from the neural stress. Lucy sells the surgeon their tape from the train, but they only get 2 days' worth of David's immunoblockers. From now on, he will need the meds if he wants to keep using his augmentation and avoid sliding into murderous cyberpsychosis. After David explains that he hasn't paid rent, Lucy takes him to her apartment. There, David drinks beer for the very first time. Lucy laughs as he coughs from all the stimulants. She messes around with his jacket and projects the word Edgerunners on the back through the jacket software. She explains, it's another word for cyberpunk. Then Lucy says she has never met a person who attended Arasaka school. So David explains to her that he and his mom weren't very well off, so there's no way the school would have accepted him off the street like that. So his mother worked hard to keep him in the academy, scraping together all the money she could. However, he knew from day one that he didn't belong to the school, and he stuck around due to his mother's dream of seeing him become successful. She takes David to her bed, uses a chip, and takes him with her to the moon on a virtual brain dance experience as they enjoy the low gravity and stare into the void of deep craters. Lucy tells David it's the first time she's shown anyone this, and she tells him they will make a good team together. They share tender moments, talking about their dreams, fears, and hopes. Suddenly, David is rudely awakened from his moon experience by a big cyborg. The big guy claims that David's and Aviston's implants were supposed to be his. David looks over at Lucy for help, but seeing her smoking nonchalantly makes him confused, and he has a feeling that she has betrayed him. At Lucy's apartment, a man named Maine, the leader of a gang of Edgerunners, asks David where he got the Sandevistan. Maine claims that the Sandevistan David installed in his body is his because he bought it with his own money. Maine reveals that he bought the Sandevistan from Gloria Martinez and that he is an acquaintance of hers. Maine had paid the amount for the implant in advance, but when Gloria didn't deliver it on time, Maine started looking for her. David reveals that Gloria is his mother and that she died just a day ago due to a car accident. After hearing this, Maine realized Gloria was unable to deliver the Sandevistan to him because she died. David offers to work for Maine and demonstrates how compatible he is with the Sandevistans. He uses the implant twice in front of Maine and his gang. Maine is intrigued and decides to give David a chance just because he wants to honor his friendship with Gloria. David returns home because Lucy lied to him, and he feels betrayed and doesn't want to stay with her at the moment. The next day, David meets with Maine's gang, whose members are Kiwi, Dorio, and Pillar. Maine tell David they will steal the navigation data from Maxim Arasaka's driver without alerting him. The plan was to send Maxim to a bar after making him lose a bet on a boxing match. Following that, when Maxim drinks and passes out at the bar, David will steal Maxim's navigation data, which is stored on a chip in his neck, and give it to Dorio so she can quickly copy it. After copying the navigation, David will put the chip back on Maxim's neck. However, the plan goes wrong because before David can retrieve the navigation data, Maxim gets up and starts to leave the bar while Pillar's sister Rebecca distracts Maxim inside the bar.
Rebecca, trip him up.
Chop chop, go.
What the fuck?
I'm so clumsy.
Watch it, bitch.
Sorry about that, handsome.
Nah, it's no problem, sweetheart.
Make it up to you next time, Kay.
Oh, you bitch!
Why are you yelling at me? I'm sensitive, you know.
David and Lucy break into Maxim's limo to copy the navigation data. When Maxim gets to his limo, he is furious to see David and Lucy sitting inside. Lucy copied the navigation data, but David had to steal the limo to escape from Maxim while having his first experience driving a car. While driving the limo, David and Lucy discover that Maxim has sent two Japanese gangsters.
Tiger Claws?
Maxim wird sie angeheuert haben.
Das ging ja fix.
Die Korpos darf man nicht unterschätzen. Deswegen meiden wir diese irren Wichser eigentlich. Rauf auf den Highway.
Sie werden höhendreckige Feinde hier! Hoffentlich einfach da kämpfen!
Sie kommen nicht hin.
To kill them. While on the chase, one of them is killed while chasing the limo. Then they arrive at their secret hideout. However, when David relaxes, one of the gangsters arrives on his bike and almost kills him. But Lucy stops him with her golden rope, and David uses his cyberware and pushes him to the side. Lucy cuts his arm, but the biker uses his other arm to slash David with his sword. But then he is killed by Maine, who arrives at the last moment and saves David. Maine is impressed by David's performance on his first day of work and officially makes him a member of his gang. That night, Maine tells David that there is no one in this world that he can trust more than himself and never betray his group. Otherwise, he will die. Then Maine gives David his share for getting the job done. The amount of money that David received was much higher than he expected. Maine tells David that whoever works with him gets an equal share. Maine then tells him that once he has enough money, he should start fixing his body with other kinds of cybertech because his skin and bones won't be able to keep up with the Sandevistan. Then a man named Faraday arrives in a car, and Maine curses under his breath. He then goes to him, and Faraday tells him he requested the data, not the limo, and he asked for discretion for the job, which they failed to do. And because of this, their target, Tonoka, is on high alert. Faraday then tells them to wait until the target lets his guards down again, and he will be in touch with him at that time. After Faraday leaves, David asks about his identity. So Maine tells him he is the one who brought them this job and also the best fixer around this area. Maine then says he is the one who gets things done, and Faraday is the one.